When it occurred to me about 6 years ago that I might enrich my YouTube offerings with some chamber music, the first such work I attempted to cover was Felix Mendelssohn's Octet for Strings, Opus 20, written in 1825 when the composer was 16 years old. This prodigious composition deserves far better than the ham-handed treatment I gave it 6 years ago, and over the past few months I'd found myself thinking fairly often of returning to this work once I'd finished my Mahler series. So it is that I've spent a very pleasant week and a half rediscovering this great, lustrous chamber music gem. This is certainly one of the most widely hailed compositions ever written. It's just astonishing that a 16-year-old boy could compose such music. In a sense, Mendelssohn's reputation has suffered because of this miraculous work for the simple reason that by writing such excellent music so early on, he had set a bar that was difficult even for him to clear. And a general impression thus reigns that Mendelssohn failed to make the great musical journey of development that a Haydn, a Mozart, or a Beethoven made. When your journey starts on such a high peak, what more heights are left to attain? The idea of an octet for strings was still a new one when Mendelssohn took this project on, and it seems that the few models that existed by the end of the 19th century's first quarter were all double quartets, that is, two string quartets grouped as such and playing antiphonally. Mendelssohn adopted a different strategy, combining the forces of two string quartets and treating them as a small orchestra. In the first edition of the score, he asked the players to play in the style of a symphony. That lends pioneering status to this work. The octet is a four-movement composition following the symphonic pattern with a conservative key scheme, its movements set in E-flat major, C minor, G minor, and E-flat major, respectively. All of the movements can be understood in sonata form terms, although there are some surprises, especially in movement four. Most performances of the work take about half an hour, with the movement one occupying almost half that time. I believe a short overview of the four movements will suffice. Movement one is the big one, a vast sonata form movement with a repeated exposition filled with vibrant themes that seem to spring from an overflowing well of youthful vigor and inspiration. The great arpeggiated surges that open the main theme infect the whole essay, used often in inversion to stirring effect. The thematic ideas are worked out over generous spans of time with a great bustling energy lying just beneath the surface of even the calmest of them. The development treats the themes in their original order and includes a dramatic stretch of music in which downbeat silences are followed by three loud, forceful, full bow quarter notes repeatedly, a passage with an astonishing forward impulse lent mostly by those very silences. The second theme's treatment is achingly beautiful and tender, and the retransition is a trickle that builds to an overwhelming tsunami of unison semiquavers that breaks upon the recap in a way that just sends me every time I hear it. 16 years old. How? The slow movement is tender and haunting, a minor key Siciliana held largely off harmonic center, opening with a hollow fifth and ending in a related way, a long tonic major conclusion that sounds half cadential without actually being that. The development's most intense moment is a severe display of French overture manners, and the recapitulation focuses exclusively on theme two, brought back in glowing C major. A little hint of theme one at the beginning of the coda suggests a reversed recapitulation, one of several formal surprises in this composition. The mood of this movement is, of course, what's important. Think of how this C minor movement relates to the big opening movement in E flat. The Eroica Symphony would no doubt have been in the young composer's mind, although this composition is not particularly heroic, and this is certainly no funeral march. More like a sweet, sad lullaby. The scherzo is the shortest movement of the piece, and in my view, the most miraculous. I cannot think of any music that has a lighter footfall than this, although Mendelssohn himself rose to that challenge again and again. Mendelssohn is the composer most often associated with the scherzo, his style practically defined by music he wrote in that vein. The taut, springy melody repeatedly touches down and leaps anew, while a shimmering current in semiquavers passed from voice to voice propels the whole inexorably through its never-relenting course. In the printed score, Mendelssohn advises the players to play this scherzo very softly and lightly throughout. At the end, it simply evaporates into a puff of G minor smoke. In most performances, the finale begins immediately, with the second cello playing a busy, robust fugue subject in semiquavers. Although the tempo marking for the scherzo and finale are different, it is obvious that their tempo must be essentially the same, for some of the scherzo makes a reappearance during the final movement's displaced development section, further anticipating, as Beethoven had already done, the cyclic procedure that dominated 19th century symphonism, with themes presented in earlier movements returning transformed in later ones. Formally speaking, this is the most interesting movement of the piece. Its first theme begins with a fugato and continues with a familiar quotation from Handel. There's more in that first theme area as well, including a stark unison passage in long bow half notes that anticipates the second theme and ties the two themes so closely together that parsing them during the return is a somewhat conjectural matter. Now, about that, following a generously proportioned exposition that includes plenty of reiteration, a solo first violin retransition conveys the music back to its original key for what is going to be understood by any careful listener to be either the recapitulation, brought back without an intervening development, yielding a piece in sonatina form, or the false exposition repeat that begins the development, as in a sonata rondo essay. But this piece is neither. That really was the first theme's recap we heard, beefed up this time with an additional subject, but this return is about to be knocked off course by the delayed development section, an austere double fugue in a rapid, hell-bent tempo, and then, most surprising and wonderful, a return of the scherzo's main theme. The themes of both scherzo and finale are developed together. The recapitulation is then finally allowed to continue over expansive dominant prolongations, and a new thrilling closing brings this whole miraculous musical gem to its vibrant E-flat major conclusion. My words are not up to the task, so it's best to let young Mendelssohn have his say. This recording was made in the studio by the Emerson Quartet, four players playing all eight parts in two pass-throughs. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.